Please turn with me here tonight to Revelation chapter 13. Revelation 13, and we're on our series, The Battle for the Mind. I believe we've come to the greatest era in all of history in battling for the mind of man. I believe it's a unique hour that we have come to. And what I'm dealing with tonight is maybe the greatest strategy of the devil to make a bid for the mind of man of any generation. My message tonight, part six of our series, The Battle for the Mind, is the mark of the beast. Reading from Revelation chapter 13, verse 11. And it says, "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him. And he causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire to come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. And he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image of the beast, which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, and the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in the right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. Let's pray here tonight together. Father, I do pray that you do bring a sobriety to our hearts, O God, concerning discerning the hour that we live in, even as we deal with our minds, the battle for our minds against the flesh, this world, nor God against, Lord God, those in around us, against the media of this generation, against the political system, against the devil. But, oh God, in this very hour, against a stratagem of hell, Lord God, a bid for the very minds and the bodies of this generation. We ask for your mercy and your grace, that there would be an awakening in the body of Christ, the church, to realize the hour that we live in, that the very stage is being set for one of the most sinister political, spiritual, religious, Lord God, social systems that we've ever seen in any generation. Father, I pray, make us to fall in love with the Lord Jesus Christ, to carry his mark, to be joined to him by the Holy Spirit of God. And Father, this night, we thank you for the precious blood of the Lamb, that my name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life since the foundation of the world. And we love you tonight. We bless you, O God, for the testimony of the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Help us and speak to us tonight in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. I want to speak on the mark of the beast tonight, not because I want to, not to be a cessationist, not to be dramatic. None of those reasons. In the past three messages, we have looked at a victorious mind, a sanctified mind, and a peaceful mind. I believe as Christians, that's the mind we need. It is the mind of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the reason I want you to see that is because a bid, a demonic bid, an extraordinary bid, is being made for the natural minds and brains of this generation. And I want to teach on what is the mark of the beast. How do we know it is the mark of the beast? What does the Bible say about the mark of the beast? I want us to look biblically at this and expound it. You know why? Because especially at an hour like this, we get the craziest ideas being taught in the church. I mean, ideas that don't come from the Bible. Ideas that contradict the biblical teaching. And I want you in this church to have a biblical view of the mark of the beast. You see, there's those in the church of our day, many of them, that teach that the mark of the beast has a connection to Islam. And that this mark is going to be an ensign or a flag or something similar. That's what they actually teach. Now, I believe that's erroneous. I believe that utterly contradicts what the Bible says. So you've got a lot of genuine Christians who believe Islam is the Antichrist system and that it's going to be a flag, an Islamic flag. Do you know what? They are not taking this from the Bible. There's others who, with new Bible versions, they say the mark shouldn't be 666, that the most accurate Bible translation says it should be 616. And they believe that we're all wrong. Now, if my Bible says you're to count the number in order to identify it, whether it's 666 or 616 makes a difference. And there's only one manuscript has that in it. And do you know what? All the new Bible versions actually lean towards that. But they've never had the courage to change 666 into 616. So they use all the new translations. They use only 5% of the documents we have, but they don't have the courage to change that, lest we don't believe what they're saying. But this is what I really want to deal with tonight, is so many are saying across the church that the vaccine, the COVID vaccine, is actually the mark of the beast, are connected to it. Now, the vaccine isn't. It can't do. And as we look at this, you're going to see the vaccine isn't the mark of the beast. Neither is it worship of Satan. But I do actually believe that it will have a connection to what is going to happen in these days. You see, all through church history, the church, genuine Christians, have always accused certain leaders of being the Antichrist. I mean the Antichrist. So far, they've been 100% wrong. So far, they've actually accused everyone from Nero in the first century all the way through to all the great political leaders of my generation, including President Obama. There are people you couldn't speak to them. You couldn't take them to the scripture. They say, but I know he is the Antichrist and he is going to take over the world. You can't talk to them. And you know what? It's humorous, yet many of these are sincere. You know what the missing link was? They never went to the Bible. I would ask them simple questions and say, well, is Obama, has he been appointed by 10 great world leaders? And as soon as you begin, that's only my first question. Their whole thesis falls apart. It's never been taken from the scripture. And so I hope you understand why I want to give you a biblical teaching on the mark of the beast and why it is so important, because so many people are saying so many things about the mark of the beast that we've got to stop. And it's a very serious hour we're in, very, very serious. And our world has changed in the past year and a half. But I want to bring you to scriptures. I want to bring you back to the Word of God tonight as we look at the mark of the beast. I want to give you seven things about the mark of the beast, and I want you to note these down or remember them. Because if what men say the mark of the beast is, if these seven things are not in place, it cannot be the mark. It is not the mark. And when you have this settled, you'll become very clear. And I believe it's very important you understand this, because right now in our world, the stage is being set for all this to take place. We are very close to it. It is at the door. It is very suddenly going to happen, but it is not in place. The tribulation has not started. The first seal of Revelation 6 has not been opened. Lots of people think because Corona is called Corona, meaning in the Latin crown, that the first rider on the white horse in Revelation 6, because he wears a crown, and Corona means crown, that he actually is the coronavirus, and great multitudes are going to die. I shared with someone recently, mature believers, and I said, have you noticed they don't start dying to the later seals? Nobody dies in the first seal. And I said, do you know the word is Stephanus in the Greek? It's a Greek word, not a Latin word. And you know what? It doesn't mean a crown of a king with spikes on it. It doesn't mean that. And I just started to lay all of this out. We've got to come back to Scripture. And I believe it's very important. If you understand the biblical teaching of the mark of the beast, and what I'm teaching you, I believe from a child, and I used to teach 25 years ago, because it's a biblical teaching. And you know what? It's going to be very applicable for this hour and generation we live in. Let's deal with these seven things, and then I'll finish with a very unique point, important point. First of all, the first thing about the mark of the beast from Revelation 13 is it is a literal mark. It is a literal mark. It says in Revelation 13, verse 16, and he, that is the false prophet, he causes all, both small and great, poor, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. When I say this mark in Revelation 13 and in the book of Revelation is a literal mark, I mean it's not symbolic. I mean it's not just something mental internally. I mean, it's not something just invisible or just something in the heart. I mean, this mark of the beast is a literal, physical, and visible mark. Notice what it says in verse 16 here. It says, he that the false prophet causes all to receive the mark in their right hand and in their forehead. This word causes all. Notice when the false prophet arises and this system arises, he is going to cause all, doesn't matter who you are, he's going to put pressure upon you. The word cause means to use force or to make. It means he's going to begin to compel all. Doesn't matter whether you're extremely rich, a trillionaire or a billionaire, or whether you're a pauper or whether you're on state benefits. When this happens, it doesn't matter, rich or poor, there is going to come a force, a cajoling, a commanding, and then a threatening to take this mark. In other words, it doesn't matter what your status in life, color, nationality, who you are educationally, there is going to come a pressure at this time, very specifically, to actually take a mark. This mark of the beast, you will be threatened. You will have pressure put on you from the highest powers in our entire world. Pressure will be put upon you. And what does it say? To take the mark in the right hand or the forehead. Saints, I grew up with this from a child, but I believe it is now at the door. For the first time in world history, we are actually there. For the first time. The word mark used here is the Greek word kerygma. It means to scratch or to etch out or to put a stamp. So it's saying here, he is going to bring great pressure to have a mark or a stamp, and it means an indelible mark. It means to go right into your right hand. It's going to be visible. It's going to be marked. It's going to be seen. But you know what? There is a mark on it, not just something worn. It's a mark in the right hand. When it's talking about stamping the hand and stamping the forehead, in Greek culture in the first century, this was really seen as a branding. It's a branding of the right hand or a branding of the forehead. This branding in the first century, or this kerygma, was used upon livestock, animals. You would actually stamp or mark or etch into your cow, your pig, whatever it is. The farmer, the owner, would actually mark his animals. And that's how this was used. It was a stamp or a mark to mark and identify animals to say, that's mine. And we still do it today. You'll see the sheep, some have a red mark, some have a blue mark, some have a brown mark. And that farmer says, they belong to me. It is a mark to show ownership. It was not only used for animals, it was used on documents to say, this is an official seal or mark to show who it is coming from. Also, this kerygma was used on coins. You mark a coin with a head, with symbolism, with words. In other words, you can identify it with a culture or a political system or with a nation. So you mark the coin, and by marking the coin, you identified it with an entire system. Also, in the first century, they would use this Greek word to mark a slave. If you owned that slave, you would mark that slave with your mark to say he belongs to your household, he is your servant, he is part of your family system. He belongs to you. You bought him with a price. So we see that all of these things were used to identify. It sometimes identified a slave or loyalty or fear. And that's what this literal mark of the beast is. The Bible predicts an hour is going to come where a system is going to come where you will have to take a literal mark on the back of your right hand or your forehead. And that mark, it will be indelible. It will be permanent. And you know what? It's going to be visible. It will identify you with something. It is an actual, literal mark. It's not spiritual. It's not just mental. You know, we read about this particular word mark or kerygma 9 times in the New Testament, 8 times in the book of Revelation. But it's used once in Acts 17, verse 21. And the Apostle Paul preaching, he talks about things that are graven by the hand of man that we worship. So it's talking about men engraving things, marking things. And that is the actual word. That's the only place outside of the book of Revelation. All other 8 mentions are about this literal mark that is going to be used. And when we read about it, it's called a mark, the mark, or his mark. In other words, this mark is always identified with either a person or as a unique thing. It's not a general thing. When it talks about this mark, you can't mistake it for anything else. When it comes, it will be utterly unique, utterly unique. Notice as well that in the book of Revelation, we know God's people, they are marked in their forehead. That is God marking believers, genuine believers, with a mark, with a seal to identify them with God. That's a spiritual mark. It comes from a spiritual person. It is a spiritual work. We understand that. And in fact, those people are preserved from this. But you know what? This mark, this literal mark, is given by men. It's not given by God invisibly or spiritually or in the heart. It is actually given by a political religious system. It is given by men. It is seen. It is visible. It is physical. It is literal. Again, look in verse 18. It says, here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. If it's not a literal mark, if you can't see it, if you can't identify it, if it's just spiritual and not physical, how do you count it? How do you count it? You can only count it if it is a literal mark that you can read, that you can see, that you can identify, and if you can, then you can count it. If it's symbolic, spiritual, religious, emotional, mental, a belief system in your heart, you can't count it. You cannot do that. It says here that in order to recognize the number, you're going to need wisdom. Here is wisdom. First of all, you need knowledge. Let him that understandeth. Do you know, I preached on this a few years ago, that first you need knowledge, then understanding, then wisdom. To get wisdom, first you need knowledge. What is knowledge? It's facts. If you don't have facts, remember what we heard on Sunday from Candace with the children. Facts are unchangeable facts. That's what they are. So first of all, you need knowledge. You need to gather the facts about the mark of the beast. People have ideas. They've never gathered the facts. They've never once sat down and written out all the scriptures on the mark of the beast, yet they're experts on it. They've never once done a personal study of the Bible. They've never once corresponded the information. And yet they'll say, I know Obama is the Antichrist. And I know the vaccine is the mark of the beast. I know that. How do you know it? I know. You need wisdom. But to get that wisdom, you can easily make a big mistake in this, and most do. First of all, you need knowledge. You need the right facts. Second of all, you need understanding. And that's what it says here. Let him that hath understanding count. What is understanding? It's taking all the facts and piecing them together in the right place. You know, a lot of people make a pig's ear of this. They pull out a couple of scriptures and they build their picture and they go, I knew Kissinger was the Antichrist. Sure, most of you younger ones don't even know who Kissinger is now. We were all told in our day, watch this man. He is the man. He's got so old now, I'm not sure he'd be able to do anything much. All these one world government men, they live up into their 90s, almost reach 100. Very few of them die young. Isn't it amazing? These great world grabbers live to a ripe old age. Notice it says here about this mark that you're to count the number. That means to calculate it. It's a very rare word in the New Testament. In Luke 14:28, that's the only other use. And it talks about if you're going to build a building, you sit down, what do? You count the cost. £1, £2, £3, £10, £20. I don't think I'll try building the building. I won't start. You count. It actually says here you're to count the number. If you can't count it, if you don't know what it is, if everyone has a different idea, it's not the literal mark of the beast. We know that we can count it. It's a monetary number. It literally means it's related to counting something. And in Strong's Concordance, it means to count with pebbles. You can compute it. You can evaluate it. So the real literal mark of the beast, you can look at it. You can begin to count up. You can look at its numerical value. You can identify it. And it says, for the number is the number of man. And his number is 666. Notice that it is an actual number. The Bible doesn't say it's an ethos of thinking. It says it's an actual number. The Greek word is arithmos. It's where we got our word arithmetic. And it's used three times. This word number, the number. This mark is a number. Three times in one verse it says it's a number. It means a fixed and a definite number. You can count it. You can identify it. It's the number of a man. We know that 6 is the number of man. That's the great number of man. And yet this is 666. The numbers in Revelation, while some are symbolic, many of them are literal. Look at the term of 3.5 years concerning Antichrist's reign. We're told not only that it will be 3.5 years, we're told it'll be 42 months. We're also told it'll be 1260 days. So you're given years, months, and days of the reign of Antichrist. It is a limited period of time. And you know what? This mark of the beast is going to be for that period of time, 3.5 years. It's a literal mark, and you can count it. You can identify it. Yes, it will be tied into a mental ideology. a spiritual framework, a whole way of thinking, an attitude of the heart, but it is an actual literal mark. Whose cattle do you mark with a stamp? Only those that belong to you, your own. Who is Antichrist going to mark? Is he going to mark someone else's people? People who love Christ, who love the Word of God, people who follow after righteousness. He's going to mark those whose mind and heart have already yielded to him. You see, some people say, I would never take the mark. But yet you are already deluded by Antichrist, by the spirit of Antichrist. Your way of thinking, your attitude, your ethos. My second point. Not only is it a literal mark, it's an identification mark. In verse 16 again, it says, and he causes all. Notice all. Both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. It's talking about an actual right hand, your right hand. He's going to try and make it an identification mark that's very personal to the individual. He causes all to take the mark on their forehead and on their right hand. Notice this identification mark. It's going to separate those out who are part of a system. It will identify you with a political, religious, worldly system. No, in fact, it'll do more than that. It will identify you with a person. A person. It is an all-inclusive mark that identifies what you think. You see, it's not the mark that damns you. It is the heart, the attitude, and the lifestyle. It is the decision that you make to identify yourself with this mark. It is all-inclusive. This mark will reveal equality. Doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. Do you know when you take this mark, we're all on the same level. It doesn't matter how poor you are. You can have the same mark that Bill Gates is going to take. And now it is an equality in this new kingdom that's being made and being brought forth. It is the great equalizer. It is the great unifier. You know how they're going to promote this? They're going to say, we're going to make sure that nobody gets missed out. We don't want to leave behind any town, any city, any culture, any color, any system. We don't want to leave anyone. I don't care how poor you are. We will pay your way to make sure that you get the mark. You're going to have all the same benefits through this mark. This mark will open up and give you access to the same financial benefits, the same rights, the same blessings, the same gatherings. Never have a people listening to a message like this ever understood it better than you and I in this hour, this year. Never have we. See what we're seeing in our world now. For the first time in any generation, we suddenly see how the entire world can be swept by this mark and invited in. Come in and be part of this system. We'll all be one. You'll be provided for in this system. There is a conformity to this system. There is a unity, but it's a unity under tyranny. You are identifying with a person, a system, a religion, a way of thinking, a belief system. And you know what? All of us are already reduced to a number. Really, all of us are. All of us have numbers that say you're a number before you're a name. That's how we identify you. Third of all, it is an economic mark. It's an economic mark. It's a literal mark. It's an identification mark. But it's an economic mark. Look at verse 17. And that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Notice here that it's an economic mark. This literal mark, this personal identification mark, is also an economic mark. The Bible predicts that our world is going to move into a realm where this mark that's so famously called the mark of the beast, that you won't be able to buy or sell unless you have this mark indelibly on your right hand or your forehead, you will not be able to buy or sell. In other words, if you have this mark, you're in the economic system worldwide. If you're outside it, you cannot buy or sell. Only he that has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. It's a means of transaction. So we begin to see and understand it has to be a literal mark if you're going to buy or sell. You see, I could be a Catholic or a secret Catholic, and I could be part of that system and say, now, do you believe this? Oh, yes, I believe. Well, then you can have your food as long as you're a Catholic. Isn't there lots of Catholics in this city? They're only Catholic in name, or if they need to get married, or if they need their baby sprinkled, or if they need their buried, then they're suddenly Catholics. They don't even know what the Catholic Church believes. But if you ask them, now, are you a real Catholic? Oh, yes, I believe it all. How do you know? You see, it's not some internal way of thinking or believing or what you'll compromise for. This is actually a mark on the right hand of forehead that ties you into an economic system. It's not a medical system. When we read the book of Revelation about the mark, it doesn't mention anything about the medical world. It mentions about the economic world. This is how you identify it. That's how I know it's not the vaccine. It's not a literal mark that you can see. Neither is it an economic mark. You say, well, it's getting close. I know it is. It's getting to the point almost, unless you take it, you can't buy and sell. But it's not that yet. We can see how all these things are setting the stage, but it is not the mark. When this mark comes into being, you will not be able to buy or sell. It will be impossible. And believe me, I don't believe there's anywhere that's impossible. Maybe certain shops, maybe certain restaurants. There's a restriction, but there's no ban as yet. Do you know there's one place in the Bible where 666, 666 is mentioned for the first time in the Old Testament? In 1 Kings chapter 10 and verse 14, we read about King Solomon and how much money he brought in a year. It's actually talking about economic power. Solomon was the richest king Israel ever had. In fact, his wealth was so great that he traded with nations all over the world. They actually say that he traded with not only Spain, but Britain as well. He also traded for monkeys from Africa. He was a great trading power, a great financial power. It says in 1 Kings 10:14, now the weight of the gold that came to Solomon in just one year was 600 threescore, that's 60, and 6 talents of gold. 666 talents of gold. That is the first time we read the number 666, and it's connected to the gold that came into Solomon every single year. He was an economic power. He had the monopoly on wealth. He was the richest king Israel ever had. The richest king we know of in the Bible. He was remarkable. Is there a connection here? I believe so. You see, I believe that mark is going to be connected to economic power in the last days. We see it so clearly. It's laid out for us. But there's something else here. Number four, it's a political mark. It's not only an economic mark, but it is a political mark. It's not only connected into the economics to buy and to sell, but it's going to be part of a political system. This is how it begins. Look with me for a moment in Revelation 13, the very first verse. Do you know that this mark of the beast is only talked about from Revelation 13 through to Revelation 20? It begins in Revelation 13, and it begins with the rise of a certain political system. Look in chapter 13, verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a great beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns. Now, in the book of Daniel, we spoke about this same beast. As soon as you read about this beast, you have to go back to Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel chapter 7. This beast doesn't exist anywhere else. You have to go back to Daniel to identify it. And notice here that the seven heads and 10 horns, that the 10 horns have crowns on it. What do the 10 horns represent? 10 kings who are going to give their power to a new political system and to a man called the Antichrist. Notice here that chapter 13 comes before chapter 17. Revelation does not flow in order. When you see the 10 horns in chapter 17, those men, God gives them a united mind, one mind in chapter 17. He gives them one mind to do what? To give all their power to the beast, to a political system. Here in Revelation 13, we see that these 10 horns or these 10 kings have crowns on their head. In other words, now they're in power. They're not just historic, it's not prophetic. Here in Revelation 17, you're seeing a political system rise up out of the land. And that political system, when you first see it, it's going to be crowned. There's going to be 10 great world leaders. And what do? These are the men. If they're not in place, we don't have the mark of the beast. Do you hear me tonight? Unless you see this economic system and this political system, the mark of the beast is not here. It's not actually here. If it's not a literal mark, an identifying mark personally to an individual, if it's not economic, not political, it's not here yet. You see, a certain identifiable political system is going to implement it. And it is this system. It's going to rise up out of the sea. And it says, the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were like unto a bear. His mouth is the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and his great authority. This is a new political system that's going to rise up. The dragon, the devil, gives it power. It's going to be a new political system in the last days. Verse 3, and I saw one of his heads, as it were, wounded to death. Remember what John said in the first century. 5 of those heads have come and gone. One of those heads, the sixth head, is in place. And the seventh head has not yet come. Do you know what? It still has not come, that seventh head. The sixth head was wounded. What was the sixth head? Because in John's day, he said 5 of those heads have come and gone. They're gone. They're in history. They were before the first century. They're gone. And then the one in John's day is in place. What was it? It was imperial Rome. It was a political form of government. There had been 5 forms of government in the Roman Empire that were based in the city of Rome in its entire history. Then there was imperial Rome. Do you know what happened to that sixth head? It got wounded to death. Do you know 3 times in this chapter, when it's preparing to tell you about the mark of the beast, it mentions 3 times that that head was wounded to death, but it was healed. In other words, this wounded head, this political system that got killed in history, wounded to death, smited the head, the 5 fell. That sixth head got wounded to death, and it hasn't been healed yet. No political system has made an agreement or been birthed in the city of Rome in our generation, but they're preparing for it. The Club of Rome was signed there, and the Club of Rome gave birth to the World Economic Forum, but that's a whole nother subject. And you know, within the Club of Rome that signed their document on Vatican Hill, do you know what they said? We're looking for the world to be divided into 10 regions with 10 kings, 10 kingdoms. And if you want to know, does the World Economic Forum have anything to do with it? This is where it was birthed. This is where it was birthed. And the writer of that document about dividing the world into 10 regions. Now I'm giving you stuff I was going to keep secret from you. But now the writer of that Club of Rome, that document, he spoke at the World Economic Forum at its 3rd conference The third Davos, that man with this master plan, they know exactly what they're doing. I am telling you about a wounded head that is yet to be healed. And you know what? That political system that's going to bring in the mark of the beast, it's going to have a seventh head, and it's going to revive. It's going to be a revived Roman Empire. It's going to be a political empire. And you know when it revives? Look what it says here. And his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast. Now, when we look at the kingdoms in the book of Daniel, four kingdoms, do you remember when we taught on it? It was a kingdom and a king. Each of those four beasts in Daniel 7, they represented the Babylonian kingdom. But also it represented Nebuchadnezzar. He is the head. Remember how we walked through that? Please don't forget that when you come to Revelation. Because when you look at the beast whose wound has been healed, you are looking at a new political system birthed by 10 great world leaders. But you're also that same beast. If you're not careful, if you think it's only a political system, you're going to miss something. And if you think this beast is only a man, you're also going to miss something. It is both. It is both. So these 10 kings give power to the beast, to a political system, to a new kingdom. And Satan is behind it. But you know as well, it's going to become one man. One man is going to become the leader of that new political system. And you know what he's going to implement is an actual mark. And this is the entire political system. We see it in Revelation chapter 13. So we begin to understand the mark of the beast. Until this political system is in place, there'll be no mark of the beast. It won't be a literal mark. It won't be an economic mark. It won't be a soul diamond mark. It actually has a history. The fifth mark, it's a religious mark. It's a religious mark, an economic mark, a political mark, a religious mark. Look at verse 11 with me. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb. The beginning of this chapter deals with the political beast, the Antichrist, or the new political system that's going to be birthed in the world. This lamb that appears, this second beast, I believe it also represents a system and a man. How do I know this man represented here, this second beast, is a man? Because when you go over to chapter 19, he gets thrown into hell. You don't throw a system into hell, you destroy it. And the Bible actually teaches that this second beast, this religious system, this man, look what it says about him, another beast coming up out of the earth. And he had two horns like a lamb. And he spake as a dragon, and he exercises all the power of the first beast before him, and he causes the earth and them that dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. Do you know who he is? He's the false prophet. He's the religious leader that works together with the Antichrist, and he makes the entire world to worship the Antichrist. Notice the description of him. It says he has two horns like a lamb. He looks like a lamb. He's got two horns like a lamb. He's innocent like a lamb. When you look at him, he looks peaceful. He looks harmless. He looks innocent. You would think butter would melt in his mouth. He has no guile. He has no agenda. Have you noticed in this hour, right across our world, that all the politicians and the doctors and the scientists, and they say, no, we care about your granny. That's why we want you to get the vaccine. That's why we want you to get it. That's the reason. We care so much about you. I have never seen so many politicians care about us as much as in this hour. They really care about us. I mean the personal, intricate details of our lives, of the people that make up our houses. They so care about us. They lay it all out. They really care. Do you know that there's going to come a religious leader and he's going to say, I so care about your granny and I so care about your children that I want you to get this literal mark so you can buy and sell because I care for you and I want you to have healthy, rosy cheeks. But if you don't take it, you'll die. That's how much they care about you. I want to warn you, the people who are saying they care so much about you in this hour, they could care less about you. In New York City now, they're coming out, the politicians and the newsmen, and they're saying, if you don't take the vaccine, you shouldn't eat, and you shouldn't be allowed in the shops, and you won't be allowed in the vicinity of the city. I had a friend email me. He says, well, I guess I'll never be back in New York City ever again. That's it. I mean, they're radical, but they so care about the population in New York that they say, we want you to take this mark, and if you don't, we won't let you buy. Do you see the picture here of what we're looking at? He's a religious leader. He looks like a lamb, but how do you know who he is? He speaks like a dragon. The message, this is how you tell every false prophet. Oh, they look nice and they've got a nice suit and they're on YouTube and they're on the Christian channel and they're famous and they talk about Christ. Listen to that message. You say, but they're a lamb. They're a prophet. Listen to the message. The message will always give them away. Notice what else it says about this false prophet in verse 13. And he doeth great wonders so that he maketh fire come down from heaven. We haven't seen this yet. We see the technology coming in now. We see the political system beginning to form in some shape. We see the religious one world religion beginning to take shape. But you know what? We have not seen this religious system take on a supernatural mark as yet. They've got technology, but they don't have this yet. When this false prophet arises, so notice we don't have the mark until this religious leader arises. He's not a Catholic, he's not a Muslim, he's not a Buddhist, he's not interfaith. He is utterly dedicated to the worship of the Antichrist. And this mark is connected to this politically, religiously, economically, it's connected. And you know what this false prophet, when he comes doing great wonders. One of the marks of this is that he can call fire down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. You will see it. He will call fire down and he deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles. How is he going to deceive? How is he going to make everyone take a mark? How is he going to make them worship a man? In this secular age, how is he going to do that? By the miracles that he'll do and by the power that he has or manifests in front of the beast. He's going to do all these miracles in front of the Antichrist, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image of the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. Do you know this religious leader is going to make an image? What's an image? It's an idol, a statue, a likeness to a man. No, I believe there's a double take in this. You see, it's got the mark of the wound. I believe this image is going to be in the image of the state. It's going to be the worship of the state. But it's also of a man or a political leader. It is both things. This image that he's going to make, I mean a statue, an idol. But notice what else it says about it. He has power. And he says to those that dwell on the earth to make the image of the beast. But it goes further. It says he had power, in verse 15, he had power to give life unto the image of the beast. Do you know that word power means self-granting? In other words, he has the power. It's not the normal word for power or authority. It means out of self, out of the flesh, out of the carnal nature, out of humanity. He has been given the power or the ability to put life in that image. He makes an image of a political leader And you know what? He makes the image come to life. The word life there is pneuma. It's the word for breath or spirit. So this religious leader is going to make this image, is going to put a spirit in the image, is going to put the breath of life. And you know what? There's two things that image does. It has the ability to speak. When it comes alive, it's going to have the ability to speak. Friends, in all that I'm reading at the minute about transhumanism, the World Economic Forum, the British government with what they're planning, with internet, do you know what they're trying to do? They want us all on internet to create the world global brain. And they're talking openly about this. They want to take that world global brain and they want to, they're now gathering information on all of you. If you have a smartphone, if you have the internet in your home, they are gathering personal information on you now. You are feeding that world brain. And you know what? I believe that world brain is going to be put in this image. This religious leader, when he's in place, is going to breathe a spirit of life into this image. He's going to have the power to grant life. And when it comes alive, it will speak. It will know everyone in the world. It will have great power, all information. We are literally there. We are literally there. And he gives it the ability to speak. And notice this other thing it's got power to do. This image, not the false prophet, not the Antichrist. It is this image. Not only to speak, but to cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. Do you see that? It's not the false prophet saying, if you don't take this mark, you'll die. And it's not the Antichrist saying, if you don't take this mark, you'll die. It's not them. It's this image. Where's this image put? According to Matthew 24, it's the abomination of desolation that Daniel spoke about. And it's going to be put in Jerusalem, where it ought not to be, in the holy place. Do you realize this image that's going to be made alive with the technology of this hour is going to be put in Jerusalem? The center of worship is going to be Jerusalem. The center of politics is going to be Babylon. And the Antichrist and the false prophet are going to work together to implement this mark. They're going to work together. This image, it's going to have its headquarters in Jerusalem, will have the power to kill a man or to give the command. Do you know, as I was reading this document on the British government website, put out by Ministry of Defense, do you know what they're saying? They're trying to create this transhumanism, internet, technological system that's going to inform governments what to do, the military what to do, a soldier on the battlefield what to do. You no longer reason things out. You get into technology, you draw on that technical information, and it tells you. I'm shocked by what I'm reading in their documents. They're talking about this already, that governments are going to say, the Irish government will say, brain, what do we do in this situation? And they'll be told all over the world. That soldier in the battlefield, should I shoot them or should I show them mercy? In that British document, it says the soldier, he'll have his mercy, his compassion replaced by that computer mind. I'm only touching on this. This is remarkable, the hour that we have come to. But let me finish with two things here. Number six, it's a tormenting mark. A tormenting mark. Chapter 16, verse 1. And I heard a great voice out of the temple saying to the seven angels, go your ways and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. This is at the end of the 3.5 years of tribulation. At the end of the reign of Antichrist, God comes forth to pour out his vials of judgment at the end of the tribulation. And he says, go your way and pour out the vials of the wrath of God. These are vessels that are filled with God's wrath. Do you know God's very patient? He's very merciful. He's very kind. He's very gracious. But do you know these vials are filled with the wrath of God? And he said, let's start pouring them out at the end of the tribulation. Verse 2, and the first angel went and poured out his vial upon the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worshipped his image. Notice this vial of the wrath of God only gets poured upon those that take the literal, political, economic, identifying mark of the beast. Remember that mark is called the mark of the beast. It's the image of the beast. This is all connected. And here, this vial of God's wrath gets outpoured upon them. Notice what happens to their bodies. A noisome and grievous sore broke out upon them. A noisome and grievous. Noisome is terribly painful. That's what it means. Terribly painful. Do you not think if you've been connected to the internet for 3.5 years? I mean, it won't even compare with what we have now. Whatever that system is that will join an individual to the economic system, to that political image in Jerusalem, you know what? After 3.5 years, you're going to start showing the signs of it. The wrath of God is going to be poured out. You know, men are going to say, I want to eat. I want to feed my children. I want to live a normal life. I want to work. I want to go on my holiday to Spain. And they won't let me on my Ryanair flight. So give me the mark. Do you know what? People to save their life, but they're only going to get 3.5 years. And at the end of that 3.5 years, it becomes a tormenting mark. It becomes noisome, terribly painful, grievous. It means it can't be fixed. All the medical help, all the technology of the age, and they can't actually heal it. But only those that take the mark, every person who takes that mark, suddenly at the end of 3.5 years, all of this is going to break out. It's the same as the sixth plague against Egypt. It was boils. You know what it done? It only hardened their heart. It only hardened their heart. It didn't soften their heart. Since it says again in verse 10, in the fifth vial that gets poured out, it says, upon the seat of the beast kingdom, and his kingdom was full of darkness. And notice they gnawed their tongues for pain. Do you know it's possible to be in so much pain physically, you bite on your tongue, you bite on it to try and quench the pain in your body. Every individual who takes the mark of the beast is going to be in so much physical pain. They took it to get food. See, nobody talks about this, do they? They don't talk about this. They talk about, you know, the cost of dying if you don't take. No, hold on a second. If you take that mark, you only get 3.5 years of economic prosperity. Maybe, because there's a lot of hellish things happening at that time. And it says they gnawed their tongue for pain. And notice this, they blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pain. They didn't look for mercy. Do you know what? They're not atheists either. Who do they blame? It's God. It's the God of heaven. And they begin to blaspheme. We curse you. We curse you, God. They know who's behind this. See, at this stage, they know exactly what's going on. They know who they're worshiping. They know what they're caught up in. They know what their destiny is. And they begin to blaspheme God. Their bodies are in pain. They know they're in trouble. And it says they repented not of their deeds. Like Egypt, under that sixth plague, Egypt didn't repent. Pharaoh hardened his heart. Do you know what they're going to do? They're going to harden themselves. The wrath of God has fallen. God's judgment is falling on this earth. They see everything coming to a collision. And you know what? They curse God and they refuse to repent. Seventh and lastly, do you see how when you begin looking at this biblically about the mark, it looks very different than what men say? Seventh and lastly, it's a soul-damning mark. The pain in their body, the torment, the gnawing of their tongue is nothing. It's nothing. That's only for a short time. And yet, do you know what? Remember that Lazarus, who had the boils in his body. Remember, he sat outside the gate of the rich man and the dog would come and lick his wounds, his boils. Do you know what? When he died, an angel came for him and carried him into Abraham's bosom, and he was comforted while the rich man went to hell and was tormented. I can handle boils like Job. I can handle boils if I know where I'm going and I know who I've believed in and I know who'll come for me in that hour. I can handle it. But you know, these men, they suddenly realize, seventh and lastly, it is a soul-damning mark. This mark will not only wreck your body eventually, it'll damn your eternal soul. Chapter 14, verse 9. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand. What a warning. What a warning. Since we are in a generation of 8 billion people, this entire generation is going to move into this. Things won't go on forever. We are not going to reach 2050 or 2040. Maybe we'll reach 2030. I don't know. But you know what? This generation we live in is about to face this. And they're about to, the world governments are now saying, we want a brain chip in every brain. The world governments are behind this. The UN, the World Economic Forum, the International Monetary Fund, America, Britain. What's the end of all this? The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture, undiluted wrath of God, of his indignation. No love on that day. No mercy for these people. You identify with a system like this. Saints, if you die without Christ, this is where it leads. Without repenting, without believing, without being washed in the blood, this is your future destiny. God help the man who commits suicide. And he shall be tormented with fire, literal fire, real fire, and brimstone, in the presence of the holy angels and the presence of the Lamb. No mercy. Can you imagine being in the presence of the Lamb and there's no grace, no mercy, no answered prayer, no second chance, no new start in life over? Do you know what you have? You have pure torment, and the Lamb of God witnesses it, and the holy angels of God witness it. It is wrath undiluted. When you look at the cross, you see love undiluted, mercy undiluted, grace reaching out. But when you look to this hour, you're seeing the wrath of God poured out. And it says the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day nor night who worship the beast and his image and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. I believe we've come to a generation, there's going to be two choices. At the minute, there's many sinners who realize what's going on. The church doesn't, it's asleep. The pastors, the preachers, they're ignorant. They've got a Bible and they're saying this will all pass in the morning and we'll get back to meetings as normal, boring everyone to tears. That's most of the preachers and pastors of this hour. But there's masses of sinners who are saying, what's going on? Atheists, evolutionists, New Agers, drug addicts, they're coming and being born again. You know why? They see all the signs, this is the end. And I don't want to be a part of that system. They're going, get me to Jesus. Get me forgiveness. Get me to the blood of the Lamb. Make sure my name is written in the Lamb's book of life. That's where I want to be. Do you realize it's a soul-damning mark? But the devil is only going to mark those that already belong to him. Those who will not come to Jesus Christ, he will mark them. And there's many who say, I'd never take the mark. Oh, I don't believe in God. I don't believe in Jesus. I don't believe the Bible. I'm an evolutionist. But I wouldn't take the mark. You know what? All those folk are going to take the mark. If you reject this Christ, there's only two choices. It'll either be Christ or Antichrist. We are right at the end. But let me finish on this note. I've given you seven marks. And I'm telling you, saints, it's far worse than a vaccination or a mask or not being able to go into the restaurant and have a nice meal. You ain't seen nothing yet. We're only at the beginning. And I would dare prophesy that I believe you and I are going to see the rise of 10 kings. I've said this for 30 years. And the system is forming. This generation is going to be offered a new intelligence. And it's forming right now. And it'll be a literal physical mark. But look what Revelation also talks about. It talks about the mark of the Lamb. It is spiritual. It is invisible. It's got everything to do with your mind and your heart and your attitude and your decisions. Look at chapter 15 and verse 2 just as we close. Give me 2 minutes. Chapter 15 and verse 2, and it says, "And I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory," notice that word victory, "over the beast and over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, the Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. Who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? For thou only art holy, for all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgments are made manifest." Do you realize there's going to be a people faced in that hour? Faced in that hour, and they're going to overcome or get the victory or triumph over Antichrist, over his mark, over his image. They're going to get the victory. But you know what? The Bible actually says the people who live in that hour, who come to faith in Christ, they're followers of Christ, believers of the Bible, worshipers of the true God. In that hour, it'll cost them their life. You won't buy, you won't sell, you won't trade. You know what? You will be under death penalty. Your life will be taken from you. You will be beheaded. But look, we look at this and we think that's being defeated. Oh no, look at it. It says they got the victory. They triumphed. How? They said, you can't buy me. You can't threaten me. You can't coerce me. You can't convince me. You know what? For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. You have nothing you can offer me. You know why? Because I see an eternal world. I see an hour where on this earth, all nations are going to come to worship the Lamb. Do you see that? And when you see these saints martyred for the testimony of Christ, you see them in the presence of God with harps. You know, you only read about harps in the book of Revelation. And you only read of one instrument in heaven. It's a harp. Brother Soph, you need to re-educate. You need to get off this guitar and learn a harp. I know the Irish are in heaven because they've got harps up there. I'm guaranteed of it. And you know what? They're singing the song of Moses and the Lamb. There's no contradiction to these. They know that the gospel of Moses is the same gospel handed down through the Lord Jesus Christ. And they're worshiping and they're praising and they're saying, you know why we're so happy? Because we see beyond all of this, we gladly laid down our life in martyrdom because they say we love Jesus Christ, we serve him. There's nothing you can make us scared of because we fear God. And you know what? We see an hour beyond this generation when all nations are going to come and worship the Lamb. Saints, it's a glorious hour. The redeemed of the Lord, it's very dark in this world. Very, very dark. We are living in the last hours of church history. And our task is to preach the gospel and evangelize and to warn men and to bring them to the Lord Jesus Christ. But I want to tell you, like Brother Clendenin always said, he said, this is their world. This is their world. We have a great reward and we've got a coming kingdom. Would you pray with me? Please stand here as we close. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, O God. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord Jesus. Father, we thank you, God, in this terrible hour when we see Bible prophecy, nor God, the stage being set, nor God, we see it politically and spiritually, economically, technology. We see everything quickly coming to pass. We see all these billionaires. We see all these political leaders, these businessmen. They are literally fulfilling scripture, not realizing that God is going to give them one mind to bring forth this beast again. But Father, thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you that this is not our world. Thank you, God, that there's an hour where all nations are going to come to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord God, we're not looking for Antichrist, but we're looking for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. What an hour that will be when we see Jesus physically, literally, visibly, when we look upon him face to face, and in the twinkling of an eye, we're going to be changed to be like him. Our entire being, our bodies are going to get resurrected. We shall have a new body. We will be sinless, dwelling with the Lamb of God forever. We love you, Lord Jesus. Thank you in a terrifying day that we can fear you rather than men. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus.